Welcome to this episode of Antiques with Attitude. We've got a couple of really interesting stories for you today. Maggie?
This week we'll be talking to Lloyd, who is the owner here at Abracardabra in Kew East. So I'm really excited to see what I'll find at his shop and see what else we can find that's interesting.
Absolutely fantastic. And we're also going to see Gerry Bell, who collects the labels off matchboxes. And he tells me that some of them are worth an extremely large amount of money, so we'll be looking at his extensive collection as well. We're here today at Lloyd Holyoaks store in High Street Kew called Abracardabra. Thank you for giving us the opportunity to come and talk to you today.
Good, Geoff.
You've been in the business a long time?
Approximately 30 years. Over 30 years.
Right, yes. And you sell books, ephemera, what do you
sell? Anything printed. Invoices, letters, right. Chocolate boxes, tins, postcards, cigarette cards, anything at all that's got printing on.
Right. And how did you get into the business?
I'd been doing a world tour after selling my previous business. Mm-hmm. I'd haunted nearly every bookshop in the world. And in our final leg at Houston, Texas, mm-hmm. I was in a bookshop there. And my wife said, the owner said to my wife, what's your husband going to do when he gets back to Australia? And she said, I don't know, and he doesn't know. And he said, well, if he's so interested in books, why doesn't he open a bookshop? So I did, and it's grown from there.
Easy gig selling books, I imagine.
Easy?
Yeah.
It's getting harder at the moment, but it's great.
And obviously you're not just a bookshop, you sell other things.
Yes. Yeah, anything and everything with printing.
With printing.
Yes.
So packaging, I can see a lot of packaging over your shoulders there behind us.
That's right.
All sorts of stands for various products, etc., etc. I saw some tea tins in the place.
Yes.
Etc. So what are your biggest sellers? What do you sell the most of?
Well, my biggest seller probably in the ephemera line is my postcards.
Postcards, right.
Basically ones that are produced before the First World War. Mm-hmm. And they're extremely popular, and collecting of postcards is worldwide as second to stamps probably now.
And what are postcards worth?
They can go from a dollar up to mine, $200, $300, $400, $500. The most expensive one, well, television reporter in the financial world. I was doing a fair at the Malvern Town Hall mm-hmm. once. He came up and asked me all about postcards, what they were and how much were they. And he said, well, what would be the most expensive one if you could find it? I said, well, I've got a few people looking for one to be extremely expensive. Mm-hmm. He said, what was that? I said, it's a postcard of the Titanic tied up in New York Harbour. He didn't see or understand what I said. But the television company here in Australia actually put that to air. And I don't know whether the producers of the TV company didn't realise my answer.
Now, Lloyd, I've taken quite a walk through your shop, and there certainly are some interesting things lurking around. So I have picked up a few things, and I was hoping you could help me talk me through them a little bit.
I'll do my best.
Wonderful. Now, first off, I found this Rolling Stone magazine. Right. And my dad's quite the fan of Jack Nicholson, as he used to love the movie The Shining. Did you ever watch that one?
Too modern for me.
Too modern for you? Okay. Well, I picked up this one, and I wanted to know, is it worth hanging on to Rolling Stone magazines?
Well, there's lots and lots of collectors for the Rolling Stone magazines. And I'm finding them harder and harder, or I should say more difficult to find at the moment.
Okay, mm-hmm. Beautiful. What would be the oldest one you'd have in the shop here?
Probably in early 1970s. That's probably the earliest that I've got.
Beautiful. Mm. Another thing that I couldn't help but pick up was the old box of chocolates. I certainly am a fan of chocolates. Now, what's the oldest box of chocolate you could probably look into collecting?
Well, the older the better. Yep. There's two people that I know of in Australia. They've done out their They've got in their homes a whole room full of chocolate boxes and anything to do with chocolate or lollies, that sort of thing, ice creams, like an old confectionery shop.
Oh, gosh, that'd be quite tempting, I think.
Yes, that's right.
Lovely. And the last two things I found, what is this? It says...
Well, that was in everybody's home. Every lady had these in her home. They're packets of blue. Reckitt's Blue was the most famous, and they're in little bags, and you dip them into the water when the lady was washing the shirts especially, and they always made the shirts, even though they were blue, the shirts came out pristine white.
Do you think I could still use that at home today?
Yes.
Oh.
Yeah.
And last but not least, I found this ginger, the More Adventures of Ginger Meggs. Now, what's significant about this one?
Well, these were done by an artist called Banks. He did these comic strips of Ginger Meggs, who was a scallywag. But his publications were extremely popular. Every boy in the 30s and 40s knew Ginger Meggs. They were fans of Ginger Meggs.
Oh, hopefully that made all the redheads a little bit more popular out there too. Beautiful. Well, thanks for that. I'm going to keep walking around because I'm sure I can find some more interesting things around.
Yeah.
Well, thanks for educating me on those.
That's all right.
No worries.
Thank you.
Welcome back to Geoff's Handy Hints. Today I've got some bits and pieces for you, so just a little grab bag of things that you may need to know if you're a collector or a restorer or whatever. One of the things that I came unstuck with a long time ago was forgetting to take the pendulum out of the mantle clock before I moved it, and I broke the hanger. It cost me $40 to repair it. So always take that pendulum out before you move the clock. When you're buying an item, you might see a lovely Clarice Cliff vase sitting in the shop somewhere. Always, always, always check it carefully for wear, because if it's got a crack in it or a chip in it or it's crazed, you might be paying a lot more than you should be. So always check it. Condition, condition, condition is the thing that's important in this business. If it's impeccable, it's worth a lot of money. If someone's played football with it, it's not worth too much money at all. Unless it was a football, of course. Pearls. I know nothing about pearls. I know they come from oysters. I know ladies like them. But if you want to see if it's a real pearl or a pretend plastic pearl, rub it against your teeth. It will feel rough if it's a real pearl. And finally, Roman coins. I once had someone try to sell me a Roman denarii. It's a silver coin. And they said, look, it's really old. It's 124 BC. 124 BC. And that actually said on the coin 124 BC. Can you see a problem with that? And very finally, if you're going to buy an object that is supposed to fit, make sure that it does actually fit. Because if I took this hat home and it sits on the top of my head like this, I'd look like a complete idiot, even worse than I do now. As you probably remember, I'm a collector of all sorts of things, mainly bank card now, but you know, banknotes, coins, all those kind of things. But way, way back in the 60s, I started collecting matchbox covers. And I've actually got this is my extensive collection, which I can show you. Gerry, don't chortle. Here it is here, one label and two pages of labels. This one's all about introduction to decimal currency into Australia. I think when that happened, when I got to that point, I probably went ahead and started collecting currency. I also remember this little book. This was published in 1960, so I was in sort of middle school, primary school. All sorts of wonderful things in here about making models out of matchsticks and also some matchsticks puzzles, which we'll be doing a little bit later with Maggie. But today, I'm here with Gerry Bell, who is a filuminist, and he collects matchbox labels. Welcome.
Thank you, Geoff.
What is a filuminist?
A filuminist collects anything to do with matches and the match industry. In other words, matchbox labels, match covers, Vestas, Vesta tins, match booklets, what we call skillets, which are the modern matchboxes, which are made of cardboard with the design printed on the surface. We collect wrappers, the wrappers that the matches used to come in. We collect old tins. Matches used to come in tins in the 19th century. And we also collect all the catalogues and books associated with the industry. And we also collect ephemera too. I know one person who collects share certificates for defunct match companies, and there are millions of those because a lot of them went broke very quickly. So it's a very wide hobby. And the sad thing is now, of course, the match industry is virtually defunct. People don't use matches or use very few matches in their homes anymore. So we're really moving into an antique situation.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And where does the word voluminist or filumini come from?
Well, it's like philatelist. It's a Greek word. There was a big search after the Second World War to find a name that encompassed the hobby. And the only one they could think of was filuminist, which means in Greek a lover of light.
Good. And when did you start collecting?
I started in 1948. A cousin of mine had a collection which was made in India before the First World War. Beautiful designs, really attractive, and he was short of a few bob, so I bought it from him. And I've collected ever since. And I still have them, by the way.
Right. And how many have you got?
I've got 85,000 about pieces, give or take. And stored in albums. I've got about 70 albums full of the other things, plus all the tins and other things which you can't store in albums. So, people say to you, well, how do you know if you find something that you haven't got? And the answer is, I know.
Exactly. I'm a collector. I know exactly what you mean.
Yeah, yeah.
Now, I know one of the things the viewers will want to know, and they always want to know this, is what's the most valuable label you have in your collection? We'll have a look at it later, but what would it
Well, mine may be $50. I don't know. But the most valuable label ever sold in Australia sold for $1,000. It was a label made in Sydney in the 1920s on... the subject is the Endeavour, the boat. Well, the ship, and there's only about five in existence, and they're all different. So this one fetched $1,000. The most internationally I've seen is an 1830s box, which went into America for about $15,000. But generally, I'd have to stress, the hobby is, you know, these things are not particularly valuable. If I pay $30 for a label, it's quite a lot. And those of you who've got jars full of labels and boxes and things that have come back from holidays overseas, sadly, these are not worth very much. There are millions and millions of them around.
But I guess the important part of match label collecting and matchbox collecting, investor case collecting, etc., etc., is the historical context. Is that right?
Absolutely. Well, I look at it in two ways. One, it's the social history of the time. If you go back, as I've catalogued the Australian imports from, say, the 1890s, they were all advertising tea and beer and commodities that were in widespread use in the house. Whereas later on, say, in the 1960s and 1780s, they were advertising restaurants and places where you visited, totally different, and pubs and what have you. One is the social history, but the second thing, it's a bit like stamps, it's art in miniature. You've got a tiny little box, and you've somehow got to get the message across to the customer that's a box of matches and it's a desirable thing. And Australia was pretty unique in that case because they had Miss Redhead, which was invented in 1946, instantly recognisable as a box of matches. Hi, Geoff. Now, here are some interesting things. This is a tin made in the 1860s, and matches in those days were called gas-camphorated Congreves, would you believe? They had a little gas bubble in them to make them light. Mm-hmm. And a box of these was found totally brand new under a house in Melbourne 20 or 30 years ago. And they're probably the only tins that are left of that particular variety in the world.
Fantastic.
Now, part of the hobby is also collecting match grips. And here's one that footy fans would like. It's a club in Tasmania that no longer exists, Sandy Bay. What else now? The first Miss Redhead came out in 1946, and this is the box from that first series. And nobody knows where she came from. One of the employees of Bryant & May said she was a copied from an East German label. But I don't think that can be true, because in 1946, I don't think that factory in East Germany was mm-hmm. operational again after the war. There certainly was a redhead from that factory, very similar to that lady. So we don't know anything about her.
Now, Maggie, you remember that when I was talking to Gerry before, I showed this magazine, Matchsticks Make Models?
Yes, I do.
It's got all sorts of instructions in there on how to make wonderful, wonderful models out of matchsticks, which is all part of their marketing program. And one of their other marketing programs was the use of matchstick puzzles. You can see that shape there, the four matches, looks a little bit like a wine goblet or a wine glass.
Yes.
And I put in a coin. Can you tell me what that coin is?
Is that a sixpence?
It's a sixpence.
Beautiful.
1923 sixpence, I think. And what I'm going to do is place that coin in there, just like it might be a an olive or something sitting in a champagne glass. And the question is, the puzzle for you is, move two matches so you've still got the glass, but the coin's now on the outside of it.
Oh.
Can you take the challenge?
I will accept the challenge.
Good, okay.
Oh, gosh.
And the goblet shape must be maintained.
Must be maintained. So can I move these two to... No, because it will be exactly the same. Actually, I think I've got it, Geoff. I think I know how to do it. Is that right, Geoff? The sixpence is outside?
Absolutely fantastic. Sixpence is outside the goblet and you've maintained the goblet shape, but this time, of course, the goblet is upside down.
Beautiful.
Well, here we are for Nostalgia Corner. We're not actually in a corner today, but Maggie, here we are in this lovely little spot looking through this gap. I'd love to sell you a couple of beers, but unfortunately we haven't got any. I had a letter this week from Robert of Geelong, and he wanted to know about LSD. And in this letter he said, no, I don't mean the drug lysergic acid diethylamide. I actually mean money, the old money you used to have in Australia. And he said that something like, I wasn't born when you had pounds, shillings and pence. So I thought Nostalgia Corner today, we could talk about pounds, shillings and pence. And I thought we'd start looking at the slang terminology for all these coins. Maggie, do you know anything about this slang terminology at all?
I really only know dollars and cents, Geoff.
Dollars and cents, okay, that's fair enough. Quid, 10 bob, people out there, think about these things. You might want to even contact us with some of your memories about the old money. So quid, 10 bob, 2 bob, the bob or the dinar, the zack, the tray, and the pennies and the halfpennies. Never say half penny because we always pronounced it halfpenny. Isn't that right, Maggie?
I did learn that. I did.
So when I was at school, we used to have to do sums of all this unwieldy sort of money. You know, 20 shillings and a pound, 12 pennies and a shilling, 2 halfpennies and a penny, etc., etc. So we'd get questions like this. If I bought 8 tea towels at 1 and 2 pence each, how much change would I get back from 10 bob, a 10 bob note? Any ideas, Maggie? Have a think. Just let it percolate through your brain.
This might take you a while. I don't know yet, Geoff.
Okay, we'll come.
I have to come back to me
we'll
on that one.
We'll come back to that. Yeah, we'll come back to that, absolutely. And finally, I wanted to talk about petrol. I didn't really consume too much petrol when I was a kid, but I do remember around about 1960, it was worth 1 shilling or a bob per gallon. And in today's money, Maggie, that's 2.2 cents a litre.
Oh, you guys had it good driving around back then.
Absolutely. So, coming back to that sum, any ideas what the answer might be?
8 something. What?
You're right. 8 pence.
8 pence. Okay.
Well done. Well done, Maggie.
G'day, and welcome to Matt's Matter of Fact. Today, I'm going to be talking about ceramics and porcelain. There are 3 main types of ceramic, pottery, that is, earthenware, stoneware, and porcelain. Earthenware is estimated to be used as far back as 29,000 BC. It's fired at really low temperatures, meaning there's no real fusing of the substance. This leaves it porous, so it needs to be glazed if you're going to hold liquid in it. It's thick and heavy, easily chipped, not translucent at all, but it is easy to make, and so this is what most hobby and amateur pottery is made from. Stoneware uses a different type of clay. It was first used by a Bronze Age civilization in Pakistan and India at the latest, 2000 BC. Unfortunately, the technology was lost with the fall of that civilization. So really, we get it from the Chinese, who developed it themselves around 1000 to 1500 BC. Now, unlike the porous earthenware, stoneware is often vitreous. So it holds fluid. Therefore, there's no real need for glaze, except for decoration. It's fired at a high temperature and is naturally grey or brown after firing. OK, now on to the biggie, porcelain. As there are three types of ceramic, there's also three types of porcelain itself. Hard paste, soft paste and bone china. Now, hard paste was first made in China possibly as far back as 200 BC. It's made from kaolin clay and feldspars, not produced in the Western world until almost 2,000 years later. So in the West, we have tended to call it all porcelain china. Hard paste porcelain has a low permeability, so it's great for liquids. It's strong, it's hard, usually has a crisp white colour, as opposed to the earthenware and stoneware and the older ceramics. But it can sometimes have a little grey tinge to it. Hummel, Royal Worcester, just two of the many that have made hard paste over the years. So, soft paste. Now, soft paste is at a lower firing temperature than hard paste, and it is more likely to crack, so it's not quite as good. When broken, the soft paste porcelain is granular and sometimes crumbly. The hard paste is smooth and hard along that broken edge, kind of like glass when you break that. As opposed to the hard paste which came from China, soft paste porcelain was developed in the West when European countries attempted to replicate the Chinese porcelain without really knowing what it was made of. They thought the translucency of the really good Chinese stuff was a result of adding glass. So they combined powdered glass with clay with some success. Soft paste porcelain found a good market throughout Europe. But of course, the English, they created their own porcelain, bone china. Now, the English bone china was initially produced in 1749, but it was perfected by Josiah Spode between 1789 to 1793. It is made with kaolin clay and feldspars, just like the other porcelains, but it also contains up to 50% bone ash, usually derived from cattle. This makes a highly translucent, wonderfully bright white porcelain, but it is also very strong. It does not chip as easily as the other porcelains, so it can be manufactured much thinner than the other porcelain types can be. And so that's the ceramic and porcelain. And if you'd like to send us an email at awa@academics.com.au, if there's anything you'd like to see covered in Matt's Matter of Fact, or if you have a great collection of ceramic or porcelain, we'd certainly really love to see it. So let us know.
Well, the audience had a great time with this. Many people thought it was a tomahawk, people said it was an axe. It's actually a laving tool. Maggie, it's a laving tool.
A laving tool.
Now, what they're used for making walls. Maybe 1920s, 1930s walls with their long strips of wood. They'd nail the strips on, and then the plasterer would go over the top with the plaster. So this particular tool has a hammerhead on it. Can you see that, Maggie?
Well, I'm guessing it's this now.
Yeah?
Yep.
And it's got a sharp edge for cutting up the strips of wood.
Right, so this part here.
And also a notch for pulling out nails.
That's it.
What
that's for?
That's it.
Righto.
It's a laving tool.
This week, as we've been talking about matchsticks, instead of having a mystery object, we're going to do a mystery puzzle. So, Geoff, could you talk us through this week's one?
I will indeed, Maggie. Maggie, to look at this one, and for our viewers, is we have six matches forming two triangles. And the question is, move three matches to form four triangles without breaking them, without bending them.
It looks like a difficult one this week, Geoff, but I think I might have an idea.
Great.
And that's it for this week's episode of Antiques with Attitude. So if you're a viewer at home with the collection, or maybe you're a youngster that would like to share the collection with us, please email us at awa@academics.com.au. We would certainly love to hear from you.
And we welcome you back next week. We've got a fantastic show for you.